All right. Hey, everyone. My name is Tuomas Mattsson. I'm sitting here with a couple of colleagues, and we thought we'd discuss some architectural stuff. So, who am I speaking with? Let's start with you.
My name is Olli Tietäväinen. I work as a Vaadin developer in support team, and I work with quite a lot of projects, usually customer projects, either support questions or maintenance projects, which are slightly longer lasting. I've been working with Vaadin for about 2 years now, and that's about it.
All right, then we have a colleague joining us over Skype from our German office.
Yeah, that's me. Hi, this is Bernd Hopf speaking from the Berlin office. I'm a Vaadin developer here from Germany for the German-speaking market. I do a lot of project kickoffs, consulting for our customers here in Germany especially. I'm working with Vaadin, I think, for 4 years now. I started, I came from the GWT, GWT development, and I'm working for the company Vaadin here for 1.5 years. So shortly after we opened the Berlin office, I joined here, and I'm very proud of it to be one of the first team members here, and it's a lot of fun.
As for myself, I've been working for Vaadin for more than 8 years now, consulting, project management, architectural stuff. At the moment, I handle our training offerings, doing training material and stuff like that. But yeah, enough about us. Let's move on to the topic of the day. So this is going to be the first in, hopefully, a series of architectural discussions centered around Vaadin and different ways you should use Vaadin. And we thought we'd start out with a concept that isn't really supported by the core Vaadin as well as it probably should, but that's relevant in many projects, and that's multi-level navigation. So we do have something called the Navigator in Vaadin, and that's a very simple tool to actually create navigation from one view to another. It has a view concept. You can replace one view with another. You can even add some parameters to that view. But it is pretty basic in the end. Bernd actually created a small demo application for you. Since this is supposed to be a mainly podcast, we won't show it to you, but we'll let Bernd explain what he did as an example and how the Navigator works as well.
Well, this sample project is actually does have two views. It may be noteworthy that when we talk about multi-level navigation, it is always about how you want your URLs to look like. Or you can think of REST-like URLs that you want to have in your Vaadin application. And so I had this demo project.
We'll put this up on GitHub, by the way, and put a link with the video or audio so everyone can take a look.
Yeah, that's right. It is on GitHub. And unfortunately, I cannot open up my development IDE right now.
Technical issues, yay.
Happens.
But yeah, you can you second. Well, we can talk about the Navigator while you're doing that. So basically what Bert has created here is an application that has a couple of views, and the navigation is done with the Vaadin Navigator, and it's a very simple URL-based navigation pattern. So in your address bar, you can see the view name, and then you can see additional parameters that you want. And I think pretty much everyone who has used Vaadin is pretty familiar with how the Navigator works.
And this is something you see in web applications that are built with any technology.
Yeah, pretty much. This address-based navigation is very convenient because it allows the browser to keep track of navigation state. So you can go backwards and forwards with your views, and the Navigator lets you do that quite easily with Vaadin. This also is like kind of a REST-like navigation as well, because you can actually take this address, you can bookmark it, you can come back to the specific place, and if you build it in a specific way, you can do like your app address slash, let's say users slash 42, and that would mean the user view and select number 42 for editing, for instance. Yeah. So that's a very typical way how you would do these sorts of things.
Of course, since we are dealing with single page applications, it's not just slashes like you would have on a website, but there's usually some kind of special character like the hash sign that separates the sort of view parameter.
Going back to my project on GitHub, the other use case that is there besides the users that Thomas just explained is there is also a products view, and that is also a pretty common scenario. You have one view, and in this view you have a big tab sheet, and the tabs on the tab sheet basically represent the second level of navigation that you have below your navigator and view stuff. You have a view with a tab page, the tabs being the second level of navigation, and now you want this second level of navigation, being the tabs, being represented in your URL. So in this view, I have that in this products view, I have just two tabs with two categories. And so if you go to product slash category A, you will see the products view being opened and the tab category A or category B being selected. And then you can have a third level or a fourth level that is in the tab category B or A. And that is also, would you agree that this is a common scenario when we are talking about multi-level navigation?
Yes, I would say so. At least I have implemented this same thing more than once myself.
Yeah, definitely. It's very typical that you have multiple levels of navigation inside one view. And in many cases, you want to keep track of which tab, for instance, you are on. But that actually leads me to the first question here for today. Do you think that your application should be able to recreate its state completely from a URL or not?
I think that's kind of a maybe misleading, in a sense that completely recreating the state might not be necessary. But of course, it's handy to have at least some level of ability to navigate to, let's use this product page as an example, that you might not only want to navigate to a certain product, but maybe there's some sub details page or something like if there's a person, you might want to be able to navigate to that person's purchase history or something with a single link.
What you usually don't want to recreate is user input or open pop-ups. So I would argue against it, but of course, even it makes sense. I would argue against that you want to recreate everything. But it makes a lot of sense even during development time, if you're working in the team, to have URLs that can recreate a certain state to a degree that is workable for you as a developer. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, I agree. It kind of depends on what kind of application you're doing, and especially if your users are using bookmarks or not. You can, of course, store a lot of data in the bookmark and have the application create quite a complex view from that bookmark, but then you might not want to, as Olli said here, you don't want to do it full on. So you don't want to store like incomplete data from a form and recreate that form with the unsaved data. That's quite overkill already. Yeah. I would say in most cases, you should think about what happens when the user presses the back button in the browser, because that's a very logical thing for the user to do, and many web applications don't really handle this properly. Yeah. What's the logical back step right now? And then work on that idea, and there you can get, okay, where's the boundary for the navigation? Is it a view? Is it a tab sheet inside the view? Or what would what would the correct level be?
Another thing is that if you refresh the page, usually you expect that the page is sort of reset so that you don't get stuck with some sort of undefined state without having a way to get out of it.
Yeah, that's a very good point too. The view is completely useless for the user if it doesn't work or if it shows some improper data because you have missed something in your navigation state that should be there but isn't.
Yeah.
A quick aside here, since we're talking about parameters and we mentioned having like a data ID in the URL, so I said you can navigate to the person's view and then have an ID of 42 and then display the ID of 42. We were discussing this earlier and a few of us were of the agreement that you shouldn't really put database IDs in your URL.
Yeah, that could be seen as leaking the server-side state to the UI and possibly causing some kind of security breach. Of course, it's mostly theoretical, but usually it's better to err on the side of being too cautious in these kinds of things. And you can usually replace base IDs with something like a hash that's not directly sort of correlating to the database IDs.
And it is not only theoretical, because the problem is if you expose a database key like user ID 400 and you have a increasing primary ID key starting at zero, you're also exposing the information that there is a user 1 to 399.
That's true.
Yeah, those are typically not randomized. There are a sequence of numbers, so a possible attacker would get quite a lot of information just from that, and they can try different attacking avenues just based on that data alone. So yeah, just a reminder, if you do have data IDs in your URL or visible to the end user, please mask them somehow, use hashes or something else. That's a good idea. And also remember that if someone can change the bookmark to another data ID, they probably shouldn't be able to access that bookmark properly. So you should always check in your application when the user is opening a view, does the user actually have access to this view and this data?
I believe there was an old Hotmail bug where you could substitute the email box ID of somebody else and navigate to that. So
yeah,
that's something you don't...
User ID basically just by changing the address. And you don't want to get caught with that.
No.
All right. That was just a quick security aside. That's very important, we think, that you should remember. But let's go back to actual multi-level navigation. So we discussed a little bit that you have views, and then you have sub-views, and then you can have parameters to these views. But how do you guys typically create these navigational engines, basically? If you have a complex fragment-based navigation system, do you use the navigator as a base? Do you use a main layout, or what do you do?
As for me, I usually, since I work in maintenance, I end up with somebody else's work. So usually it seems that people don't use navigator that much, maybe because some limitations there. Could be that they have started with Navigator but noticed that, okay, this doesn't work for us, so we need to do something of our own.
Yeah, that's kind of what I've seen as well in projects that I've run, is that the Navigator is good for basic cases, but you pretty soon will need something that the Navigator can't provide. What about you, Bernd? What's your...
Well, I have not... There was just once where I have this scene at a customer. So for me, this is more a theoretical point of view from what I find to be most elegant as a solution. I would actually try to use the navigator as long as it is possible in any way. And then in your navigator, in your onEnter method of your view, you need to You get your parameters, you get the parameters, and the parameters are basically the path of your REST-like URL without the first part of your path. Because the first part of your path is the name of your view, and after that, the rest of this path comes. So what you have to do then is to set up your UI stuff according to this REST-like URL, and you need some form of parser. Then I would argue that the best thing is, at least to start, is to have one monolithic state machine parser that goes like, if your parameters start with edit, then you need the edit view. Like, say you have a user has opened up users/edit. You know that this is an edit view. The edit view needs a third parameter, like the user ID behind it. Then you have users/edit/ I don't know, user ID, UUID. And this parser, I think, should be monolithic, should not be distributed. And what you can also do, a different way of approaching this, is you have regular expressions. You create regular expressions for every possible URL pattern that a certain view is handling, and then you do it this way. You see, is this applicable? Is this regular expression applicable? Is this applicable? Is this applicable? If so, regular expressions give me your parameters, and that is a parameter of your user ID. But since the regular expression for editing users is applicable, you know that you need to set up an edit user setup in your view. Was that understandable, or was that a little confusing? It's hard to tell.
No, I think that's pretty much what I was thinking as well.
I think whenever you involve regular expressions, it's going to get confusing no matter what. So not much you can do about that. But yeah, I do agree. That's typically how I start as well. Even though if you might migrate to something more complicated, then starting with the navigator is a good idea, because you can still customize the navigator quite a lot. You can add like listeners for before view changes, after view changes. If you use your own view display, then you get full control over where and how a view is actually added. So you get a lot of control if you customize those parts, that you can implement this sort of parsing, and you can implement security checks and everything else around the basic functionality of the navigator.
And I would say that the view interface is definitely usable even if you don't use the navigator, since it has some quite useful methods that you should probably implement anyway.
Yeah, definitely. So we're pretty much all in agreement that at least in the beginning, you should centralize your navigation into a main layout of sorts that should probably use the navigator as well. And then if you need to change to something more complicated, then you only need to change one place and rewrite the navigation part in your main layout, and you don't need to fix your views anymore. They can still receive the same parameters or method calls or however you want to do it.
Yeah,
because also our navigator API does have more benefits. It also has a integration in CDI frameworks like Spring that you probably want to make use of. You can attach a navigation listener and stuff like that. That is not something I would throw away easily.
No, that's a very good point, actually. I typically use CDI in the projects that I run, and it is very convenient to have that integration.
Yeah.
All right. Can you guys think of any reason why you would like to have URL parsing in the view itself, just to cover that part?
Well, sometimes you might want some special functionality in a certain view. Like, for example, if you happen to have some kind of structure that only happens in a certain view, that you need to specially parse it in that view, maybe. But even then, it's more like you parse view parameters and then deal with them in the view.
Yeah, So depending on how you do your parameter parsing, you can just give the view an array of pre-parsed things and let the view decide. Yeah, I would agree with that.
Yeah, I would agree too. I have not had too many projects, so I don't really have seen both sides of the argument, so to speak. But just out of gut feeling, yeah, I would agree.
Typically, your application has a bunch of similar views, and since we're doing business applications most of the time, it typically is CRUD based. So you have a listing view of some sort, and then an edit view of some sort, and IDs of some sort. And it's going to be pretty much the same anywhere in your project. But then there's typically always one or two views that do not do this. For instance, there might be a view that needs two separate sorts of data. They need a customer and a booking, and then they need to match these two views, and then suddenly your single parameter doesn't work anymore. And then you can add more parameters and have the view itself parse that data.
Yeah. Quite typical example, I think, is that you have, for example, some kind of date range that you want to show in a certain view.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. You can just add the parameters to the URL and then let the view filter its content based on that.
But that would not be a REST-like URL, right? I mean, a date range would sound to me more like a query parameter.
That's true. I would agree with that as well. It's questionable if you should put this in the URL or not. You can put that data anywhere else as well. Yeah. But then we're back to the question, should this view be bookmarkable, and especially should these parameters be part of the bookmark or not?
Yeah, of course, then you always expose yourself to that. What if somebody fills in a date that doesn't exist, like February 31st? Then you need to sort of be aware that it might be somebody's typing something into the URL bar, just trying that if this works, or even maliciously trying to cause some kind of error situation on the server.
Yeah, even if you have a very limited use internal application, then there might always be one clown who just notices that, ooh, you have dates in your address bar. What happens if I put a null in there? Yeah. And I've seen that multiple times from people that I would not expect that sort of behavior. But it is common, and as programmers, it's our responsibility to just not let that sort of thing happen. If you're using parameters in your URLs, as we mentioned earlier, make sure that you parse them before you actually act on them.
Yeah. And also, that is another advice I would give. If you are writing the parser code, write it from a perspective: what exactly do I want, and not what do I not want, and write it like I have five cases or five patterns of parameters that I'm okay with, and go through check your parameters if they match with each one of these cases, and in the end, if it doesn't match, then just throw an exception and say, I don't know what to make out of this. This is my approach to writing a server from this side. Do not anticipate what you do not want. Just focus on what you are, exactly. What you do want.
And that's, if you want to test your navigator as well, then that's a very good way to do it. Just make sure your navigator works for the cases that you have specified, and then have a defined error state for everything else. And then it's much easier to handle that.
That's one good thing about the navigator, that it gives you automatically the possibility to define error pages, and want to make use that. You want to make sure that you have a decent error page set up.
Definitely.
All right. I have another question here. So we've talked about like normal views, listing views, CRUDs, that sort of thing, and subviews even. But I've had a couple of projects where the navigation actually, or the state of the application involves overlays. So like full screen pop-ups for different things. They might be like configuration things or wizards or something like that, that are started from a view. So you have something that pops up on top of everything else. You have the old state underneath, but then you have this new state, which might be quite complex. For instance, if it's a wizard, it might have 5 different stages. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Should this be included in your navigation state or not?
I would be kind of careful about that. At least it sounds like it could be sort of confusing if you navigate into the middle of something that you haven't started yourself. It might even not make sense from a sort of application logic point of view, that if you have a wizard, should you be able to start it from the middle? It could be, but maybe not.
Yeah, there are still these, like, if you've ever filled out some sort of form, like you get an email saying that, hey, please fill out this survey. Yeah. And you can typically stop those in the middle and then come back.
Yeah, but from an application developer point of view, you need to especially develop that kind of saving behavior before you can have it.
That's right. And also, I would argue that then you would get, in this case, like, say you filled out a form, and halfway through you interrupt it and you get an email. The email should contain a link with an URL that just contains an ID of the form that you filled out, and then the application is responsible of tracking in which state the form was and reproducing that. But the state of your form should not be part of the URL.
Ah, okay. So you serialize the state of the form somewhere in your database and assign that's
right.
A unique ID. Yeah,
I can agree with that.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, actually.
Because you probably don't want to navigate to page 2 if you have filled page 2 and 3 and 4. You want to come to the last page or start from the beginning, but not somewhere in the between.
Yeah. I just realized here that we actually talked about like pop-ups and wizards, and then we jumped onto the survey immediately. But let's go back to this pop-up idea. So you at least always said that you don't think it's necessary to include pop-up state in your navigation handling.
No, I don't have a really good explanation, but at least I feel that often when I use a website, and if the first thing that comes for me is a pop-up, which is a pretty common these days in advertising, it feels like something happened that I didn't do. Mm-hmm. And did I do something wrong? Did I accidentally press something? It doesn't feel right to me. It feels like the application is working without my consent.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I can see that. Typically, when I create like editing views and realize that, okay, I have this small panel for editing, I can't fit what I need to in here. For instance, if I need to select an item from another place, I need to create a pop-up with a search and filters and stuff like that. I would agree I wouldn't put that pop-up in the navigator because it's an atomic action, really. You either have nothing selected or then you have something selected. I think the states in between don't really matter. And that's where the pop-up is. So you would open the normal edit view, but then leave the pop-up out. And if the user wants to do that, then they'll have to start that smallish operation again.
That's right. I think pop-ups should always just take you from one place to another. And they should. I would discourage from using pop-ups as a method of gathering user information or filling out forms. I mean, there are maybe different opinions on that, but I like it more when there is a actual form that is not a pop-up, but just a, here you create a new item forms. But I can also think of setups where this would make sense. However, in general, I would say pop-ups I would not include is maybe a good rule of thumb. For multi-level navigations.
Okay. We'll have a couple of examples of different architectures later on where I will let you know about a project where we actually did have pop-ups in the URL, but we'll talk about that later and we can discuss if it was smart or not. We do have a couple of examples here about real world cases. But before that, do you guys have any other comments or things that you thought of during the discussion?
No, not for me at least.
No, me neither.
Then Olli has prepared a small showcase explaining how one of our customers is using the Navigator in a customer project.
Yep. So this is one of our maintenance projects. It's been developed originally at Vardin, I believe, but that was quite some years ago. At least it started before I joined the company.
It was 3 or 4 years ago.
Yeah. So it has gone through quite a few phases. It's a production, of course, by now, but it has also changed quite a lot from the original inception. The application usually has this quite typical master detail pattern that we've talked about, that you have a sort of navigation framework, like a navigation bar, and then you have a detail view, and you click on some menu and it opens. And they have this simple REST-like URL, which we talked about, that you have some kind of object that which you want to show, so you can pass on an ID, and it opens up in the details view.
Yeah.
But something that they do a little different is that they also have some kind of hierarchy in their data, so that they have the same application available for multiple clients of theirs, and that's the top level of navigation. It could be that, like, for example, administrators can see all clients at the same time, but also of course might be that some clients have more than one top level in their navigation menu. They also have different locations per customer, so it could be that we have a Turku office and a Berlin office, which have different people and different items in them. And then the last level is the viewed type of item. It could be some kind of dashboard, or it could be some kind of object they're observing there, or it could be a data point in one of their locations. So they to visualize this, of course, this shows in the URL, but this also, they have this breadcrumb style of navigation tool which shows on the top of the page. So it shows the client and the location and the item they're currently viewing. So you can click on the breadcrumbs and suddenly move back to view the locations of that are available for your client and so on.
Mm. So what parts are present in the fragments then? You said that there's multiple levels of this data. Are all of them represented in the fragment?
It depends, because they have multiple views. The fragments are different based on the view. If you are looking at the locations view, there you will see on the fragment the client and the location and maybe some sub location, so that you could have A/B/C, for example, in the URL. But if you look at let's say data points view, then you have just data point / the name or the ID of the data point.
Okay.
So it's custom based on the view, and also, but the breadcrumbs always states the correct, the full path.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Something that's this kind of slightly more complicated URL structure brings you, that you need to be quite careful when you are handling the URL, both when you read it and when you also update it, so that there's quite a lot of code dedicated just for URL fragment handling.
Mm-hmm.
URL fragments are not only read, but they are also updated when the view is changed. So you need to make sure that, okay, now we have this kind of entity on our hands, so let's update the URL correctly, so that you can just copy the URL and the person who gets the URL can navigate to the same view and the same entity. And the entity names are free for the user to type, so could be that they have some special characters. So those need to be taken into account. For example, you could have a slash in the entity name, so you need to make sure that that's not actually sort of a sub part of the URL, but you need to check that is this something that is actually not a separator here, and things like that. And quite a lot of these have been found only after somebody has made a mistake with these. So suddenly location names with the slash stopped working because the parsing went wrong.
Yeah, that sounds quite typical. That's a bug that I'm not sure if I would understand to avoid immediately either. It's like, why would you want to have a slash in this parameter?
Yeah. And they also use these URL parameters that are not this kind of REST type that, like I mentioned, the date ranges and things like that, that you can pass in some fixed parameters, and you can also edit those in the URL and get the right result.
One question, is the URL parsing done on a main level, or is it per view, or is it a hybrid of the two?
It's a hybrid because in some cases some parameters are passed onto the view so that they can decide that what they want to do with this. But mostly it's done, it's kind of flat in the sense that you just get the view and then you get the parameters and you pass them, but there are some special cases where you also need to take care of them in the view.
Okay, sounds quite interesting.
And one thing that they have done correctly is that they don't use the database IDs, but instead they have a hash code that's been generated for each item, and then that's shown in the URL.
Okay. Bernd, do you have any comments on this pattern?
Actually, no.
Does it sound reasonable to you?
I'm sorry?
Does it sound reasonable to you?
Probably. From what I have heard now, I would not know any way to do it differently. And so I guess that is the best way to meet the customer's demand. But I don't know, Ollie, would you, no, in retrospective, would you do anything different than you did the first time?
Maybe so. Of course, this wasn't done by me. I've only been maintaining it, but yeah, it has grown organically. It's not sort of at least fully by design. So now that I've thought about it, this, for example, this regular expression based approach with only valid URLs getting a real response sounds like it could have saved us some trouble.
Yeah. Anything that grows organically is prone to issues later on. I have an example of this very shortly. But yeah, when you keep adding like special cases to navigation, for instance, then it's quite tricky in how you add new stuff to it and how you add new features.
Yeah, I think that's something that we all have faced one time or another, that doing it later always makes it more difficult. So
yeah, definitely.
It's good to think about it at least.
Yeah. Okay, so that was one quite interesting example on how you can use the even built-in features of the Navigator to do some quite complex stuff. My example is slightly more organic, let's say. So a project that I started a couple of years ago, the first version of the application was very much like a master details view. So there were listing views, and then there were edit views. And we used the Navigator for like the pretty typical, that okay, listing view and then ID and then edit the file. And the UI had two panes, basically the listing and then a side pane that opened from the right where you edited the files. Then we got the requirement that, hey, this one side pane actually has a link to this other data object. So let's call it, for instance, that we were looking at bookings, and then the booking has a link to a customer. And hey, I want to see the customer information in this panel. So I want to click on a link, and then the side panel needs to change to a customer. Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. Those were separate view classes on code level, so we can pretty easily replace the booking info with customer info. But now we had the situation where we have like a custom or a booking listing with a selected booking, and then a customer info with a specific customer open. And then when the customer saw that, hey, this is actually quite possible to do and easy, oh, hey, can we do this particular thing? And then they wanted to link a third thing and a fourth thing. And then we suddenly realized that, okay, these two panels that we have, the let's say main and secondary panels, they aren't actually linked in many cases at all. Yeah, in some cases you have a listing page and you press something in it and then it opens up in the details page. But the details page can actually contain whatever. It can be something completely different. And in some cases even, you want to browse to a customer, select a customer, and then start browsing something completely different while having the customer panel open on the side.
Yeah.
And suddenly we had two different panels with independent navigation state. So we realized quickly that, okay, the navigator isn't well suited for this. It's mainly done for like single pane or single panel inserts. You put the view in a specific place and you keep it there and you feed it parameters. That didn't really work for us anymore. So we had to figure out a way how we could create a new navigation system that's still fully bookmarkable. The back button needs to work, so you need to be able to change the panel content with the back and forwards buttons of the browsers. So what we did was that we wrote a completely custom URI fragment handler and our own navigation system. So basically in our main layout class, we created code that will handle updating and reading the URI and then change the parameters on depending on what the view tells the main layout that has been selected, for instance. And then also, of course, navigation state changes. So when we want to actually give a command that, hey, I want to open this view in this panel. So we basically had to rewrite that whole navigator utility that we have in the core, but make it more complex for our application. So we did this, and it was quite a success. Of course, we found a couple of bugs there, but we got that fixed. And then the customer decided that, hey, I want more space for the secondary panel. We had had it like a fixed size for quite a while. I think it was 300 pixels wide, so not very wide, but still like a reasonable for an edit view. It had a simple form. But then our customer's info panel started to have quite a lot of data in it. It had a tab sheet, sort of. I think it had 6 or 7 different tabs of data. And the customer said that, okay, this is all nice and awesome, I like the navigation, but I can't see the data of my customer anymore because the panel size is not good enough. It's too small. Okay, fine, we can make that bigger and user toggleable. So we made it 3 different sizes. So the side panel could now be the normal original size, or it could be closed as well, of course. And then it could be a big size, which was, I think, 600 or 700 pixels wide, which made the listing page then again like 300 or 400 pixels wide. Or the last case, it could take up the whole screen estate. So it was full size and the listing view wasn't seen at all. And the user should be able to toggle this size with small buttons and then keyboard shortcuts as well. So if they want to see more customer information, they just quickly type alt left or whatever we decided on, and then the side panel will expand and so forth. The listing view, even though it wasn't visible, it needed to be there and it needed to be represented in the state as well. And then of course, this needed to be bookmarkable. So we needed to add this parameter into the URL. So now we had a URL with 5 parameters. First one was, what type of screen positioning do we have? So basically, how big is the left panel from zero, which was invisible, to one, which was small, then big, then full screen. Then the second part was what is present in the main panel, so the listing view, basically area. And that had a view name, and then it had optional parameters, typically an ID of which item should be selected in the listing. And then another part where we had the side panel, same thing, which view and which ID, so for instance, which customer, and then maybe even some other parameters on top of that. So we had like five different things, three of which were numbers and two were basically view names, and then some specific views could have even more stuff, and we had to have our own separators, and the parsing logic became really complicated. And of course, after this, the customer decided that, hey, this big overlays that we have in the application, these need to be represented as well. And that's when it all broke down, because suddenly you have the old state with five different parameters, then you need more parameters, which should denote that, hey, this is now, this could be a normal view, it could be a listing view, but it should be in the overlay instead, and it could have something selected, and so forth, and so forth. And that's basically where I left the project, because of completely different reasons, I'll have to say that. So I accepted a new position here at Vaadin at that point. So I'm not completely sure how they fixed that in the end, but when I left, there was talk about rewriting the navigation again, because it had grown very organically to be a very big and complicated piece of software. Especially when you think about the updates of the fragments. So whenever a user did an action in a view, then maybe that action should be reflected in the URL as well, but maybe not. For instance, if we select something new in the listing.
Mm. That's actually something that I maybe forgot to mention in my example, that the updating of the fragment was quite complicated, since you need to, every time you take an action, you need to update the URL if it's something that you might want to copy and navigate.
Then you have to rebuild the whole address as it was previously with your change somewhere in the middle. So it is quite complex, actually. And as well as in your project, this project had a lot of code dedicated to this specific thing. And a lot of code in the navigation structure and the main layout to prevent cascades of events happening when we triggered the wrong update. So for instance, let's say we have a listing view and then we have an information view open at the same time. And then I select something new in the listing. Well, that's a navigation event because that's what we decided it is. So we want to navigate in the second panel to a new customer. Okay, how do we actually do that? So what do we update for this to happen? Should we just update the URI or the URL fragment and hope that our navigation will pick that up and then do the necessary changes? Or should we change the actual view in the navigator and then let that change propagate to the fragment? And I don't think we ever decided on like a specific way to handle this. It just grew over time, and it wasn't horrible by any means, but it did become so complex that at some point we couldn't understand what the navigation was doing anymore. And that's one of the reasons why we really, really like started discussing that, hey, we need to rewrite this. And we told the customer as well that we can't actually add any more features because we don't understand what it does now.
But this was all things that came from real-life users, from
yes,
real requirements.
Yes, definitely. And all of the requirements that they had made actual sense. So the end result was very usable. It was awesome to use when you were doing the work that our customers were doing, because they could have two independent panels with independent information. They were calling their end customers, like, and filling in data in one panel, jumping back to another, maybe had to do a quick search on some third thing. And all of this worked beautifully. We just had no idea how it worked. Yeah. So it was very, very complex, and definitely an example on where the navigator doesn't help you anymore, where you have to take the bold leap and actually write your own navigation stuff. I think we all agree that at some point in a complex project, you have to do that. And we all agree that you should be very, very careful when you're designing this. And ideally, know the requirements beforehand. We didn't, which ended up in an unmaintainable situation. But if we would have known all of these features beforehand, then the situation would, of course, be completely different. I think as software developers, we live in a constantly changing world, so it might not be reasonable to expect full feature sets from the beginning, but still it's good to know, like, what are the additional possible maybe features that the customer wants in, and then plan a little bit for that as well.
And I think in this case, it might have been beneficial to have some kind of idea of the actual workflows of the end users.
Yeah. And that was as well something that we discovered along the way, because we had we had a demo installation for the customer where they got to play around with this. So they had, for a time, they had their old system and our new one side by side, and they were working, and then they realized that, hey, this would make sense. And then we added that to the requirement. So it was a very dynamic process when we were building it. But yeah, the end result turned out fine, and I hope the guys managed to rewrite it after I left the project. So I'll have to go and ask. But it did end well, as far as I know. I haven't heard any screams, at least. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was my example. Does Bernd have any comments on this? You've been a bit quiet.
Yeah. I was not really. Just that it is a that seems to me like the most feature rich or the most advanced or whatever you want to however angle you want to look at it. But this example that you just have given, that was like when I heard of it the first time, that was like, you have everything in here that you can think of when you're thinking multi-level navigation.
But would you say that this is something that is sort of generic, that is this something you could can up and make an add-on or something out of?
I think making an add-on of this would be very, very difficult. Of course, it was completely tied to how our views actually were working. We were using CDI events and stuff like this to manage the navigation. And I could probably try to package it as an add-on or rewrite it, but it would be quite a massive undertaking.
Yeah.
I still think that the same patterns could be used in other projects as well. So it might make sense to try that. But it does need some very specific use cases to make sense.
My general belief is that these very complicated multi-level navigations are not very easily generalized, since they are very application specific.
Yeah.
And it might not make sense in a different context. It could be that you can reuse some parts of it, but there's also the risk of making sort of this computer scientist that I want to make this solution that works for everybody, and then it's usable by nobody.
Yeah, and that's something I've seen, at least in very big companies, they have this tendency of building their own internal frameworks, and all of their applications should follow the same patterns and same procedures. And in some cases that works. If you just have CRUD applications, then sure, go for it. But if you actually want to have usability through navigation patterns and through these specific tools with different panels and so forth, that's very rarely useful in other projects, as is.
Yeah, that's true. I know what you're talking about. And in many cases, this is a little off the topic, but just my two cents is in many cases you in many companies you have a guy that started a project and he has a clear, he's sort of a clear pattern on how to go forward. And this pattern brings you so far, but then eventually you should always be prepared to rethink your approach instead of just going through with it no matter the cost. So that is more like a general software development advice, maybe to from time to time rethink your approach and don't just blindly follow with what you started with.
Yeah, definitely. Of course, agile is all the rage and everything. Big companies might not be as agile as other ones, but there's no reason not to rethink a solution to a problem if you realize that your current solution just doesn't work anymore. And yeah, if you're running a million code line project, then you might be just screwed at that point. But I would say that for the most part of the projects on the scale that at least we are working on here, there's always the possibility to rewrite something that you think doesn't work anymore. You always need to have that in the back of your mind. Does it make more sense to rewrite this now or spend countless hours fighting it in the future?
If you go back a little bit to your example, if you had the chance to do it again, would you like to have this kind of centralized fragment handling, which is sort of agnostic to the usage of, so to provide this fragment handling API, so that you just push whatever state you want into it and it just handles it all perfectly? Or would you still rather have some kind of like context sensitivity when you handle the fragments?
I would still like to have the option of overriding behavior if I really need to. Like in your case that you said earlier that most of the views work in one specific way, and that's logic that you can build into a centralized place and should as well. Yeah. But there's always those one or two things that don't fit that pattern, and then you have to do custom stuff for that. And I think it's more logical for me to put that in a view instead. So, for instance, the view might have a flag saying that, hey, I'm responsible for my own fragment handling. Please, main layout, don't mess with it. Just give it to me. You don't know what to do with it anyway. So, like this sort of thing. I would still say be careful with that, because if you do a lot of that, then your code is unmaintainable and unreadable, because all different views do their own thing. And then I would say that, yeah, rethink maybe the patterns that you're using. But like in one or two cases, well-defined cases, I would say it still makes sense for the view to be able to override the behavior.
Yeah.
Okay. I think that was pretty much all the topics that we wanted to discuss today. Let's quickly go through some of the pointers that we have for everyone, just like small ideas, small snippets to make your development life as painless as it can be. So I would say we all agree that the Navigator is a very useful tool, and especially for smaller projects and for projects that don't need a lot of custom handling. And we do recommend that everyone starts with that.
Yeah. And like I mentioned a short while ago, you should probably plan ahead, do some kind of customer demos or prototypes or something, how your end users will use the application, plan how they should be able to navigate, how should they be able to share links, and so on.
Yeah, especially like sharing links is a very good point. I think that's very important. If your users are collaborative in that they want to share links to the system, to each other, then your navigation, of course, has to be able to handle that. And then that will dictate what features you will need.
One other development advantage that comes to my mind, that is a little it maybe sounds a little obscure, but it helped me out a lot once, was if you use JRebel and you are working on a Vadin application, then you can have like a development that feels like you're working on a script, right? You just save the file with the code you have changed, you recompile real quick, and you reload your page, and the changes are there. However, this only works if the state of your application is in the URL. So that is also a small advantage that you have.
Yeah, that's a good point. I've had a lot of help from that particular feature. I like the way to develop applications like that. I didn't remember to add this button to the layout. Well, just add the line, refresh the page, and it's there. You don't actually have to redeploy and like restart the application to get that. Of course, JRebel does most of the heavy lifting, but the fact that you don't have to go to a login and then navigate through 5-6 sets of data to get to your one little layout or view that you wanted, that's very useful.
And if you have test bench tests, this will make your life much easier, since you don't need to have the same type in username, type in password, click login, then click on menu item X, and then so on.
You can just navigate directly to a specific part of the application and test that. Yeah, that's a very good point as well. Another top tip has to do with security. So if you're using these fragment-based navigation techniques, always check the action before you actually execute it. So check, does the user have access to this view? Does the user have access to this data? No tool, Vadin or otherwise, can help you with that. You need to do that yourself all the time. But remember to do it. It's such an easy mistake to make, to forget that handling, and it's such a gaping security hole in your application if you don't. So please, please remember to do that. Okay, what else as top tips go? Pop-ups, overlays, don't bother putting them in your navigation state, at least if they actually are pop-ups. We were talking about wizards or surveys a bit ago, and if you have that requirement that you need to come back to a specific place, then as we mentioned, you can serialize the state and just assign it an ID, or then you can create your navigator to be custom to that specific case. I would say that a survey application, the main idea is to do surveys, and it's not like a view ID-based system anymore. It's a wizard system that's different.
Or you could argue that each page of the survey is a view of its own.
Yeah, exactly. So you have a lot of options there, and you should probably try to think a little bit outside the box in that case. Where you should put the parsing code, pretty much all of our projects are done so that the parsing is mostly central, because you have the 95% of all use cases are the same, so that code can be put somewhere central, and then views should be able to override that. And the last thing, well, we already covered this a bit, but yeah, think ahead. So if you have to redo your navigation at the end of the project, make sure you do it well. Preferably, you don't want to rewrite anything at all, but in many cases, you simply have to. And in that case, the sooner you do it, the better. And when you do, take a long, hard gander at what are your customers doing, how do they want to use the software, what features can we add now so that we don't have to do that later on.
Yeah, and also think about that while if you are thinking about changing your navigation, think about that it also has quite wide-ranging impacts, like in the security we mentioned, or like because it's sort of it's not just one thing you can test easily, because it's something that interconnects the application. It can break in unexpected ways quite easily.
Yeah, definitely. And the more complex your fragment handling is, the easier it is to break. And when your navigation breaks, then your whole software is unusable. You don't just break one view, you break everything. And the customer might not be very happy with you if you break the whole system for a week when you try to hunt down the little refactoring bug you did. But yeah, I think that's it for us for this very first architecture talk. Thank you guys for joining me.
Thank you.
If you as a listener want to see or hear more of this, please send any of us a message. And if you have any topics, we'd be glad to have those as well. We have a couple of topics lined up, but we don't have any specific plans for them yet. There are channels internally for this if you want to. If we put this up on YouTube, then please leave a comment below. We'll try to read them and then see if we can accommodate your requests. But yeah, I've been Thomas. These are my guests. Thank you very much for watching or listening. See you next time.
See you.
See you. Bye.